Chapter 12. So, your name's Echidna. Naruto said, narrowing his eyes at the white-haired girl, feeling suspicious. He was feeling a bit unsure that this is Echidna. She looked nothing like a witch, though he looked nothing like a trained assassin, and she looked very much alive. Another reason why it was hard to believe that's her was that, she couldn't be that young. That reminded him of Beatrice's apparent age, seeing as she looked around 12 and was actually around 400 years old. Now this woman right here, sitting on a chair with a teacup, was introducing herself as the Witch of Greed, someone not only far older but far more like dead. What's up with that reaction? I am a very delicate woman, you know. She said, an edge of annoyance in her voice. Are you, really? Echidna? Naruto asked slowly, pointing his finger at her. Did I meet the wrong person? Perhaps I walked in the wrong place. I mean, surely the name Echidna can't be that uncommon. Echidna's jaw dropped in shock at his unsure reaction. Wh what? Hold up. I just told you, I am Echidna. The Witch of Greed. She said as she pointed her finger at herself, but she seemed ready to explode when she saw the human just turn around and began walking away. Sorry lady, but it seems I'm in the wrong place. Perhaps you can help me find Dash. I'm right here, you idiot. Echidna is me. Can you just take a seat here and have some tea? She said, breathing like a berserker. She calmed herself as she crossed her arms and gave him pout for turning away. Could this guy seriously not know who she really was? Naruto turned to the girl who was trying to convince him that she was the Witch of Greed. He detected no lies from her, and she's convinced she's a witch. He was going to entertain her, if she was telling the truth she created the sanctuary and the barrier, and maybe she could tell him how to destroy the barrier. Alright, alright. You're Echidna. My name is Naruto Uzumaki. The blonde shinobi said as he walked and took a seat. He noticed Echidna's pointing at the teacup, no doubt for him to drink. Sorry, I don't drink tea. I only drink water or juice. Tea is the only thing I have here. Gosh, why don't you like tea, young human? I heard if you drink too much tea, you can't grow taller. Eh. That's not true. Tea is good for old people. Well, I'm a young adult, but believe me. I can drink this tea and there's a good chance I can grow taller. Guess Naruto had no choice but to drink tea with her. Besides, this is his first time drinking tea, he was curious about the taste, the fact that a witch had made it for him made it all the more peculiar. However, he noticed this tea had something weird, it could probably taste bad, but since when was he known to be careful? He took a deep breath before drinking his first tea. His eyes gazed at Echidna, who had a surprised expression. Naruto set his empty teacup on the table and looked at her. Wow, you actually drank all of it, even though it was something a witch offered. Echidna said. Then, what is this tea made out of? Why did you offer me to drink the tea in the first place? Naruto's voice became serious, like he knew something. His body felt weird after he drank the tea but managed to stand against it. You have sharp eyes, Naruto. The witch said in surprise. It was my body fluids, but I'm going to tell you more since you interested me. I applied treatment so that it'll be easier for you to familiarize yourself with the witch factor sleeping inside you. Instead of the green face she expected him to have, she saw no change in his expression, it was clear she never visited Mountain Myoboku. Witch factor. Naruto wondered, having heard the same word from Beatrice after he told her he killed Petalgius. I'll tell you a bit. More importantly, if you are the one who killed Sloth, what happened to the witch factor Kashira? Was she talking about the same witch factor? Naruto didn't know if it was because she didn't tell him and he didn't ask her. However, Echidna seemed just about to explain it to him. I'm impressed you killed an adherent of the Witch of Envy. When that adherent died, the witch factor transferred to you. Though, it seems there's something else inside you as well. Echidna said as she set her teacup down on the table and traced her finger along its edge. Her gaze locked on Naruto, black eyes met azure. This boy is just a human, but his mana is powerful and definitely something inside him was as well. Unlike the other humans, he looked alien, like he wasn't from here or maybe not from this world, his smell was definitely something that she found out of the norm. Is she talking about the bijus or the witch scent? Naruto thought. Let's talk about that later. Don't you have things you want to say, to ask? Echidna asked. Yeah, I do. So I entered a tomb only to end up here, what happened to my body? I know I didn't teleport. You're correct. Your mind's inside my castle. This place is a dream. So his real body was most likely knocked out in the tomb, left it there at the mercy of wild animals. Then, can you tell me about the trial? So that I can help my friend break down the barrier you created that traps the demi-humans and humans in the sanctuary. He said. Sorry for telling you this, but I don't know about the trial. I haven't participated in it. Stop lying to me, Echidna. I know someone who already took the trial. Echidna looked at the human's sharp eyes. He had the nerve to tell her she's lying. No human has ever done that before. I'd love to tell you, but I'm not allowed to speak about the trial. You must pass the trial first, and then I can tell you. She said. Okay then. Can you tell me about the six witches? He asked. Very well. Allow me to tell you about them. Echidna grinned before she did something to their surroundings. The atmosphere of blue skies and green fields instantly started collapsing. The sky shattered, the fields caught flames, the world beyond the horizon progressively collapsed. Naruto saw the table shatter like glass except for the two chairs that they sat on. The whole place became a dark void. So, what would you like to know? Is it about the Witch of Gluttony Daphne, who created godforsaken beasts to save the world from hunger? About the Witch of Lust Camellia, who sought to fill the world with love and gave emotion to those without others? About the Witch of Wraith Minerva, who punched all people into health while lamenting the strife-filled world dash? Wait, what? Witch of Wraith Minerva, who punched all people into health? Naruto asked, blinking his eyes in confusion. Yeah. Some people are confused about her ability, so you're not the only one. Echidna said, continuing to tell him about the witches. Anyways, where was I? Got it. Is it about the Witch of Sloth Sekhmet, who drove the dragon beyond the Great Cascades just for some peace and quiet? About the Witch of Pride Typhon, who brought judgment upon criminals with the innocence and ruthlessness of a child? Naruto shook his head, not wanting to know about them. Though, he stored all the information about the witches in his head, just in case. Is it about the Witch of Greed Echidna, thirst for knowledge incarnate, whose vestiges even now linger posthumously in this world, desiring all wisdom there is? Or is it about the Witch of Envy Satella, the one who destroyed all of the other witches, and the one who turned the entire world into her enemy? Naruto's eyes turned serious and sharp fast when he heard about the Witch of Envy. His chakra flared up in response to his raging emotions. He had a lot of questions about Satella. Why the serious face? I guess I overdid it, but this is my first time seeing you look like that. Echidna admitted truthfully with a raised eyebrow. I have a lot of questions about the Witch of Envy. Naruto breathed slowly, preparing himself to use his power to deflect what was more than likely going to try to kill him. What do you know about? Return by death? He tensed his muscles in preparation for what was about to happen. Nothing happened, that was weird. The last time he and the Bijuu gave a name to the strange power that brought him back to life the last time, they had to fight back a lot of shadowy arms that invaded his mind and tried to squeeze his heart. Thankfully he wasn't alone and all of them fought the annoying things till none remained. Return by death? Sounds unfamiliar, but I think I've heard it before. Echidna said with a thoughtful look as she put her finger on her lip. She was so sure she heard it before, but she couldn't quite put her finger on it. The witch didn't seem to recognize that ability, but he hoped she could give him information. I might know that ability, but can you describe it? What does it like? She inquired. Whenever I say, return by death, suddenly Shadow Hand grabs my heart and squeeze it. I noticed their unseen hand, just like Petalgius' ability. Naruto said. Satella. What? I've never heard about return by death, but unseen hand belongs to Satella. If I'm correct about what you saw, you're the only one who can detect the unseen hand. Nobody can see them, but somehow you can. Her words made sense to him since he had sensed and seen Petalgo's shock at him not only seeing them but destroying them as well. Naruto knew he could see the unseen hands but he was unaware others couldn't. He fought Petalgius alone and in sage mode since the very beginning, so he saw them without difficulty. But that brought another question, did this world had sensors? Even if they couldn't see them, they surely could sense them, right? On another note, he wasn't surprised that the unseen hand belonged to Satella, considering one of her devoted followers had them. But if what he sensed was right, then the Witch of Envy gave him return by death, seeing that the unseen hand had a similar feeling, Satella's power more than likely. But, why did she give him that ability? That voice, could it be? Naruto thought as he looked at Echidna. Can you tell me more about Satella? 400 years ago, Satella absorbed Envy Witch Factor, but things went very wrong. Her magic went out of control and she killed the other six witches of sin while nearly destroying the world. She said. Out of control. Was it because her magic took over her and made her kill the other six witches? Naruto asked. You're correct. I'm surprised, you didn't seem all that intelligent when you didn't recognize me. Satella and the Witch of Envy are separate personalities. I see. Naruto said softly as his fists opened slowly, he was absorbing the new information with an open mind. He finally found what he was missing, something underneath the underneath, that told him that things weren't as transparent as they seemed. So, can you let me meet the witches? Yes, I was planning to let you meet them anyway. Echidna said. Good luck meeting them and have fun. So, who are you? Naruto asked, looking at a little girl with green short hair. He was surprised, he was expecting a lot of things regarding the witches, he wasn't expecting them to be pretty girls, especially one so young. How could this little thing represent a sin? She has red cheeks, tan skin, and wears a white and blue one-piece dress. She also has a blue flower hairpin. She stared at Naruto as if looking at an alien. Typhoon, the Witch of Pride. She introduced herself as she pointed her finger at him. Who are you? My name's Naruto Uzumaki. Echidna told me about you, she sent me here to meet you. He said with an outstretched hand in greeting. Eh. So, you're Neru. Typhoon said as she smiled happily at Naruto, she gave him a short name too, things seemed to be going well. Neru, are you a baddie? Naruto blinked his eyes in confusion at her question, he finally shook his head. I'm not a baddie. He said. Typhoon walked toward him and tilted her head at him. She grabbed Naruto's outstretched hand. Feeling how soft it was, she was surprised his hand was so soft and warm. He didn't seem to be a baddie, but just to be sure. Huh? Naruto heard her whispering but didn't hear what she was saying. He was going to ask her, but suddenly felt a light shock. He felt a pull so he curiously saw his outstretched arm, no he didn't, he couldn't see what wasn't there, his arm wasn't where it was supposed to be. Why? He looked at Typhoon who held his arm, looking at him intently. He blinked for several seconds before he screamed like a little girl. His reaction was priceless and quite ridiculous. It doesn't hurt so you're not a baddie. You're a good person. The Witch of Pride said with a smile, noticing Naruto running around while screaming in shock. Stop yelling. It'll fall if you move too much. And if you do, you won't get it back. Naruto realized he felt no pain and his wound wasn't bleeding. With a deep breath he calmed himself, it was a dream, he remembered, though looking at the stump that was his arm he could say it was scary to see his bone and pink muscle, even if it was a dream. So, can I have my arm back? He asked, approaching her, but suddenly his body lost balance and he fell forward into the little girl's lap. The blonde quickly looked at his legs and his right one was suddenly gone. He sighed and facepalmed. He noticed Typhoon stroking his hair. She smiled lightly at him with a small giggle that sounded so very pure, he couldn't just stay mad at the little witch, even if she was responsible for him losing his leg and arm. Ha! Very funny. You're a kind person. Your hair is so soft. She said. I guess it's time for you to meet someone. Naruto was going to ask her who, but suddenly the place changed. Typhoon, who was with him a second ago, was no longer here, but he found another woman in her place. His azure eyes meet the magenta eyes. She looked a little older than his and Echidna's age. Was it just him or her expression looked tired? Her magenta hair was extremely long. Her skin and lips seemed abnormally pale. She wore a dirty and frayed clerical robe. Hugh, looks like I'm up next. Sigh. I guess I have no choice but to do it. The pretty woman said with a lazy look as she began to stroke his hair. Asterisk sigh asterisk you're pretty heavy but your hair is very soft. Sigh you're quite lucky. Being sent by Echidna, then to Typhoon and now me. Having face-to-face meetings with three witches in turn, that's something only a handful could say, that moron Flugel or Reed, Swisher of Sticks. Sorry, who, never mind them. Are you a witch? Naruto asked. Asterisk sigh asterisk I'm Sekhmet. It's really a chore but I guess you could call me, or not call me, the Witch of Sloth. Sigh not that I'm asking to be called at all, it's really all a bother. Hugh, chatting makes me restless, so can you stay quiet? Sekhmet asked as she continued to stroke Naruto's hair. However, I have to admit your hair is soft. Naruto Uzumaki. It's nice to meet you, Sekhmet. Naruto said, staring at her familiar expression. She reminded him of someone. You know. You kinda remind me of my friend. The magenta-haired woman raised her eyes lightly at him. I remind you of your friend? She asked curiously as the blonde nodded to her. Well, he's lazy and sleepyhead who always says, what a drag. Just like that when someone tells him what to do. Naruto imitated the voice of his friend, causing the woman to giggle softly. Anyways, can you help me get my arm and my leg back? Phew, nothing I can do, actually this works fine. This was a pain for me too, phew, so I'll just leave the rest to her and go to sleep. Ha, breathing's such a damn chore. Sekhmet said as she looked at him. Hopefully the next time, we will meet again. Wait a minute. Are you talking about Minerva? Naruto wondered, starting to sweat a little after he learned about Minerva's witch magic. Ugh. I think I might pass this one dash. It was too late when he saw a different person and Sekhmet no longer with him. He found a pretty blonde girl with blue eyes. She wore white and blue clothes that are easy to move around in. Looking at her, she seemed to be his age. The blonde girl didn't look bad at all, but, why is she looking at him with some anger? Right arm missing. Left leg missing. No bleeding or pain, you got punished by Typhon. That girl, she went off doing whatever she likes again, she's just awful. She yelled as her eyes clouded over with fury. Her whole speech filled with anger, her attitude explosive, her actions were filled with violent passion, tears welled up in her eyes. Yeah, it was pretty easy to guess which sin she was. Naruto's body was shaking with fear at her attitude. He was having flashbacks of the other healers he knew and their anger. Are you mad? He asked out of reflex, thankfully he didn't call her granny or the story could have ended very differently. I'm really mad. That Typhon, making these wounds and just leaving them there. And at this world that lets her do these awful things. And at people fighting and hurting each other and making each other suffer, the craziness of it all. Okay, now she was rambling, another trait he was beginning to associate with healers. Now, Naruto started to get really scared of her. So, you must be Minerva, the woman who can heal people by punching dash, he screamed loudly as Minerva tossed him up into the air very high and he landed in her arms. I won't forgive it. Not pain. Not fighting. Not wounds. As if I could leave it like this. She yelled, her shining eyes stared at Naruto as she tossed him in the air and began to make a strange pose with her body, no doubt about to punch him. Oh no. Oh no GH. Now then. How did it what happened to you? Echidna wondered, looking at Naruto who seemed to be defeated after meeting the three witches. The blonde raised his head to look at Echidna. Things are great, but, Minerva. Does she always do that to people? He asked, his tone one of acceptance. Yes, that girl's just a little too quick to put her dukes. You have to get used to her and her healing magic. She said as she drank the tea. I'm happy you enjoyed meeting the three witches. How come I met only three? Can't you just let me meet five of them? Naruto asked. Ikinda's brows furrowed, feeling troubled. Her gaze wandered around for a while, eventually coming to look at Naruto. Well, you can meet Carmilla tomorrow, but Daphne. I really think you better not meet her. She said. Why not? Well, you and Daphne would have a terrible affinity. Or you could even call it horrid. Even if you met her, a useful conversation wouldn't take place. You see. Can you not meet her, ever? I can only let you meet Carmilla tomorrow. What's wrong with meeting Daphne? I can tell you that later. Just not today. Echidna said. Naruto blinked his eyes at the witch wanting to argue, but he just nodded and listened to her reasons. Well, he met three witches, Typhon, Sekhmet, and Minerva, so that was cool. But, he didn't meet the other two witches, Carmilla and Daphne. Tomorrow, Naruto would meet Carmilla. However, Naruto doesn't know why Daphne was a bad match for him, but he had no control of this realm, it was Echidna's, he was grateful she allowed him to meet the witches, even if they weren't all. Echidna dash, the blonde paused as Echidna got closer to him. He felt a fingertip touch his forehead, and something transferred inside him. I'm giving you the qualifications to take the Tomb's Trial. The qualifications? Does that mean dash? If you have this, you'll be able to take the trial at night. Whether or not you take the trial's up to you. But, now you have the option to take the trial instead of that important girl of yours. Do whatever you like. No, that's it. It was nice to meet you, Echidna, you and the other witches. Naruto said, walking toward the door created by Echidna. The first thing Naruto felt when he woke up was the touch of someone's fingertips stroking his scalp. He didn't have a headband on his forehead, its familiar weight no longer present. His eyes opened, but a slender hand blocked his view of the world. He caught a glimpse of Emilia's beautiful face, looking worried at him. Emilia. Where am I? He asked, his eyes scanning his surroundings. He noticed the walls were quite old. It seemed like he's out of the dream world and out of the tomb. In the house on your bed, Naruto. Emilia said, continuing to stroke his head in a soothing manner. Naruto nodded as he attempted to get out of the bed, but his memories held him back. He put his hand on his forehead and remembered meeting Echidna inside her dream, and the headache that had been meeting the other witches. She told him she gave him the qualifications to take the tomb's trial, so he could help Emilia now, so he guessed that the mission was successful, in a sense. Emilia pushed him down with a little force and he just plopped on her lap without offering resistance. She was worried about him, and him stopping out of nowhere could have made her think he had some sort of headache. You mustn't get up. You haven't slept as much as you should, so just stay in your bed. She said, gently pushing Naruto's chest with her hands to stop him from leaving the bed. The blonde sighed in defeat, but he couldn't say no to the half-elf. He just lied down on the bed for her, noticing her hands still touching his chest. This made him look at her. Naruto saw her face turn red as she realized her hands still on his chest and pulled them away slowly. He didn't have his armor plate because she took it off so he could sleep better. Emilia was embarrassed about her actions, but she still tried to not let him go. She was worried, really worried, after she found him unconscious in the tomb. So, what happened to me? Naruto knew what happened to him when he entered the tomb, but what happened after was a mystery to him. You suddenly fainted right after you went in. I was really worried. Emilia said. I really didn't know what to do. It didn't look like you'd been injured, or affected by any kind of strange magic. Naruto, did something happen to you? I'm fine. I met Echidna in her dream mentally, which explains why you saw my body unconscious in the tomb, since it had no mind to control it. You met the Witch of Greed in her dream. Yes, I met her and talked with her. She doesn't seem to be that dangerous to me, but I would prefer it if you didn't meet her. Emilia is a half-elf, so he wasn't so sure if she would be so civil with her like she was with him, since a half-elf killed her and the other witches. Worst case scenario, Satella attempts to murder Emilia immediately. He had to be relieved at the fact that he now had the qualifications to take the trial. Emilia, I want you to know that I got the qualifications to take the tomb's trial, Echidna gave them to me. Ah, really? How she gave them to you? I don't know how, but let's not worry about that. If you're uncomfortable taking the trial, I can go inside and do it for you. Naruto said, not wanting to reveal the fact that he drank Echidna's fluids. Something told him that wasn't going to go well for him. But Naruto, I thought the tomb's trial only lets a half-elf or half-human take the trial. I am dead serious, Emilia. And you know me, I never dash. Emilia interrupted him by grabbing his hand with hers as she looked into his eyes. What if you fail the trial? I don't want you to get hurt like Roswell or trap inside there forever. You did so much for me already, and I want to do something for you. Please, let me take the trial. She said as she grasped his hand. Naruto did so much for her because he cares about her, and she never had a chance to repay him. However, it didn't seem like he wanted any kind of repayment for his actions, only doing them because he thought that those were the right thing to do. It wasn't very fair for her not to help Naruto. Even if he was powerful, he was just a human, and he would surely feel good if compensated for his efforts. She wanted to do this for him. Emilia. Naruto said softly, didn't know how to respond to her, so he just smiled and nodded his head. She really wanted to help him, who was he to stop her surge of determination? Okay, Emilia. After Emilia received a yes from him, she released a beautiful smile to him, glad to know that he trusted her with the trial. Thank you, Naruto. I won't let you down. She said as she still held his hand with rosy cheeks. This time, she's going to confess her feelings to him again, just like the other day. She made sure no one was going to interrupt them this time. She took a deep breath to calm her heart and her mind. She had been waiting for this moment for a little while now. So with nothing else to lose, she just took a leap of faith, trusting her melting heart and ignoring her mind feeling her head with insecurities. Naruto, I want to say something to you. Yes, what is it? I'm in love with you. Naruto looked at her with surprised eyes, not believing what she was saying. "WH, what did you say?" he asked. "I love you, Naruto," she repeated, hoping she was letting her emotions show on her eyes, just like in the books. "W, when I first met you, I was afraid that you would run away from me because I revealed to you I am half-elf. But, you became my first friend without so much as a second thought. I am saying that you're not scared of me, and I really like that about you. Not that you don't have any more qualities I like, it's just dash." Naruto was speechless, his jaw was slightly opened, his eyes wide. He couldn't believe Emilia confessed her feelings to him. Poor thing was spitting out whatever came to her head, and her face was beginning to imitate a tomato, not that he was any better right now. Finally, Emilia calmed down enough to speak properly, placing her hands above her heart and taking another deep breath. "And Naruto, I love you because you gave me a chance and, you saved me from my loneliness. I hope I'm doing it right," the half-elf said, looking away from his face with a nervous chuckle, trying to hide her teary face. "You understood my feelings and helped me fight through the hardships. Then, I started to realize that your feelings were just like mine. Both of us were hurt, scared, we felt weak. I like the way you hold me. We ate together, studied together, and a lot more things I didn't even know could be enjoyed like you taught me to. I know this is selfish, for me to ask you this. But see, can you stay here in this world? I want you to stay with me, I want to continue to live my life with you." She closed her eyes, preparing herself for the worst. Some tears ran down her face when she thought of the possibility, and her hand squeezed his in an effort to comfort herself. Why hadn't she thought about this before? This would change everything between them, how they talked, how they interacted. And if he said no? Could she take that? She didn't know. "Yes, Emilia." Those words washed over her like a bucket filled with nothing but relief. She looked to him with a smile on her face. "Are you really?" she asked, feeling unsure. "Yes, Emilia. I accept your feelings, and I will stay by your side until the end," he said softly, taking a knee in front of Emilia, noticing her sparkling smile and watery eyes. He took her hands in his and thought about what to say next. "Do you remember the reward you offered me?"
"I remember.
Well, I finally know what my reward is going to be. I want you, Emilia, to visit my world with me if I ever find a way to go back." Emilia widened her eyes with shock, covering her mouth with her hands, feeling extremely happy that Naruto wanted to present her to the people he thought of as a family.
"Are you sure?"
I am a half-elf dash, she said, her insecurities coming back with full force.
"I'm sure my friends would love to meet you,"
Naruto said as he held her cheek with his hand and used his thumb to clean her tears.
"You don't need to be afraid of them.
Trust me, Emilia. They're good people and I'm sure you'll like my home. I'm happy. I'm so happy," Emilia said with a smile as she cupped his hand.
I never had someone who wanted me to visit their home. What should I do?
If I visit your world, what should I do?
Well, you can do anything you want.
Just be happy and enjoy yourself, Emilia. You deserve to be happy. And don't worry so much, not even I know if this is possible.
Thank you, Naruto.
Thank you. She jumped to hug him, wrapping her arms around his neck, causing Naruto to land on his butt. Her voice was full of happiness, she couldn't help but hug him after she heard such a sweet offer from him. She couldn't help but hold him tight, her life had never been as happy as it is now, all thanks to one man. She now had friends in the people of Erlem Village, she was trying to make a difference for the better in her own world as the king of the Lugnica Kingdom, and she was now in a relationship with her perfect knight. She was sure that many things awaited them in the future, but she felt that she could conquer it with him by her side. Naruto couldn't help but hug her back, her happiness was certainly infectious. If his fears were true, then that meant going back to his homeworld was nothing but wishful thinking, but since when was he stopped just because of that?
"Emilia-sama. Is Naruto-kun awake?"
Their moment was interrupted by Rem's voice coming from the other side of the door. This brought them out of their thoughts and their elated emotions, making them realize the position they were in at the moment. Emilia was straddling Naruto's lap and he was holding her waist with both his arms, this made them blush automatically and they quickly separated, leaving them in awkward silence, neither of them having experience with this kind of situations. Standing up, Naruto coughed a little to ease the tension in the room and approached an embarrassed Emilia, burying her face in her hands, her pointed ears glowing red.
"Emilia, Rem needs us."
He offered the half-elf a hand, hoping she would snap out of her embarrassment before they kept Rem waiting more. Emilia took a second,
seeing the offered hand through a crack she made with her fingers, and finally took his hand in hers, looking anywhere but him. Let's go. This time it was Amelia who spoke, leading him to the doors quickly to distract herself from her embarrassed state, breathing slowly to stop her face from glowing red. Through all this, her hand never left his. Naruto and Amelia got out of the room to see Rem with an unknown kid. Naruto-kun, Amelia-sama, I want you to meet Luiz. She said. Luiz is a little girl with long, wavy pink hair. She was looking at them with a calculating gaze, betraying an intelligence above that of a normal child. She seemed as old as Petra, who was around 11 or 12. She wore a white robe with dangling sleeves, her hands barely visible. I am Luiz Meyer. I'm the representative of this sanctuary, more or less. Luiz said as she scratched her forehead with barely visible fingers. I apologize for interrupting you too, but are you boy who went in the tomb? She looked at Naruto. Name's Naruto Uzumaki. Yes, I went into the tomb. Luiz's eyes scanned his body, seeing he was a human, but with a presence that made her think otherwise, that and he held himself like a trained warrior, muscles ready to strike but seemingly relaxed. Oh yes, Naruto-kun. Roswell wants to speak with you. Rem said, noticing him growing uncomfortable with the little girl ogling his body as if looking for something. Okay. Naruto said as he looked at Amelia, who held his hand with hers. She was now looking at him concerned. With the recent events all playing so fast, he totally forgot about his animosity towards Roswell and what Amelia thought of the whole thing. It's okay, Amelia. I'll just talk with him. He tried to reassure her, but she still seemed hesitant. The half-elf got a gentle kiss on her knuckles from Naruto to ease her worries. Okay, Naruto. She said smiling, blushing slightly at the foreign, but not unwelcomed, action. She let go of his hand and watched him start walking away before he stopped briefly to say a last, nice to meet you, to the representative of the sanctuary before continuing his path. The Hokugai has fallen and the Cardinal of Sin targeting the village has been repelled. Congratulations for become Amelia's knight, by the way. Roswell said with eyes closed, still in bed and rubbing his chin. Roswell called him to ask him the things that have transpired while he was gone, and Naruto saw no harm in doing so. First, allow me to convey you my gratitude. I thank you for protecting my land and people. And, being her first knight, I cannot thank you enough for the great service you have devoted to Amelia-sama. Roswell expected at least a half-hearted, thank you, from the blonde. What he didn't expect was silence. Intrigued, he opened his eyes to look at the blonde but was met with an unamused expression from the blonde, one could even call it spiteful, or even hateful. You don't seem happy to see me. May I ask you why? Roswell asked. You know why I'm here. You left us even though you knew of the possible danger, why? Naruto said, keeping his emotions in check. I've been in confinement here, so it isn't as though I left the mansion unattended for a few days on. Then, you got injured like that by challenging the trial to free the Earlham villagers you put here in the first place. Me, Amelia, Rem, and the others took care of the witch cult while you were gone. You abandoned your people and left them to their luck. You knew that would happen. Arguing with someone who gets angry at logic does pay off. Truly, a good trend. Naruto didn't get angry at his words and barely looked fazed. Roswell, you better explain to me why you're in the sanctuary. He said, his tone getting deeper as he took a step forward. He made a promise to Rem and Amelia, so he wouldn't kill or even injure the already bruised clown, but he wanted answers. Unfortunately, his action was confused as Rem quickly got in front of him to protect Roswell. Roswell-sama is burdened with his injuries. Even so, he surely could burn you to naught dash. Don't interfere, Rem. I won't hurt him. Naruto said harshly as he glared at the pink oni. I just need answers. I know you're still loyal to him because he saved your life, but I won't hesitate to put both of you down. He understood that, like Rem, Ram had a strong sense of loyalty toward Roswell for saving them, so her actions were not out of hate but out of loyalty toward the clown, so he didn't hold them against her, since he would do the same in her shoes. Ram shivered at the very cold glare Naruto was currently using against Roswell. She stepped aside reluctantly since she knew Naruto would just barrel his way through her without a problem. She knew him to be a man of his word, but he didn't seem to be the kind man she knew him to be right now. It's okay, Ram. You heard what Naruto-kun said. He won't hurt me, he just wants to talk. Roswell said with a smile. As you say, Roswell-sama. She said. Glad to know we're on the same page. Now, you promised Amelia that you could melt the ice encasing the Elier Forest if she becomes a king, can you? Naruto said, crossing his arms as he glared at the clown. Oh my. I never thought Emilia would tell you about that. But I can see why she trusted you so much. Roswell said with a chuckle. The truth is I can't melt the ice of Elier Forest with my magic, but there is a method that can melt the ice without hurting the people. Which is? Dragon's blood. The blood of the dragon, that grants bountiful harvest upon the land and cures deviant earth. It wouldn't kill the dragon, the only thing needed is a drop of blood. If Emilia-sama becomes king, she'll get a chance to ask the dragon for its blood. He was telling the truth, he didn't feel anything that pointed to him lying. It was a bit underwhelming that the only thing needed for such an important task was a single drop of blood from an oversized lizard, but who was he to judge? Feeling the atmosphere of the room lose some of its tenseness, he decided to sit down on a chair beside Roswell's bed. Any more questions, Naruto-kun? Roswell asked. Just one. Can you tell me about Emilia's life? Night comes, the atmosphere sure is spooky around here. It looks creepier than yesterday. Emilia said, holding Naruto's hand as she turned to look at him. Do you think it's fine to go in yet? It should be fine to go in now. Naruto said, no longer seeing the sun in the sky. Are you sure you can do it? I'm sure I can do it, Naruto. Believe in me. Emilia said with a smile, raising her pinky finger to him. I promise I'll return to you. Why? Are you worried about me? Emilia seemed to have gotten bold all of a sudden when she fluttered eyelashes at him in a mockingly innocent gesture. It seemed her was rubbing a little of his attitude on her, that or she was reading too many books. The blonde's face turned a little red, making her giggle. He held her pinky finger with his, something small children would do if they wanted to seal a deal. Seeing themselves make such a childish ritual, they laughed at each other. She smiled at him one more time to assure him she'll be okay before she entered the tomb to take the trial. I'm going now. She said as she stepped on the stone stairway and the tomb's lights flickered to life all of a sudden. The tomb light up. Naruto seemed surprised. Perhaps it was something similar to Fuinjutsu. It's proof that the tomb has recognized Emilia-sama as someone who has the requirements to take the trial. Luis said. Naruto watched Emilia enter the tomb feeling a bit of fear when he thought of the danger she was in if she failed. This though led him to think about those that once had his back, was this how they felt once? Worried about him, but being unable to stop him because he was such a knucklehead? Now he felt like a dick. Naruto, calm down. The tomb has welcomed Emilia-sama into it. You don't need to worry. Luis said. You know what it consists of. I've taken it before. If you're a half-breed and it judges you're qualified, it comes naturally for you. In the end, I wasn't able to beat it. At that moment, everyone held their breaths when the tomb lost its light source. The lights. Rem said surprised. They're meant to stay on while the trial's going, but... Luis looked kind of lost, even though she should know what's going on. Without a second thought, Naruto ran toward the tomb, ignoring the others who called his name. When he entered the cemetery lit up for him, he was inside the tomb looking everywhere and trying to sense any magic. He felt something trying to reach his mind, fortunately, the tailed beasts and his own resistance to psychological attacks held strong. He was beginning to grow annoyed since his senses were being affected by the tomb, but sighed in relief when he found a pair of slightly open doors, leading to what? He didn't care. He goes through big doors to find Emilia lying on the ground, unconscious. He was relieved to see that she wasn't injured like Roswell, even though he knew she was able to take the trial safely and the clown wasn't. Finally growing bored of the thing trying to enter his mind, and knowing that Emilia was in no danger, he relaxed and told the tailed beasts to drop their defenses, but to be cautious of any danger. He quickly lost consciousness and fell to the floor next to the half-elf. First, face your past. A voice said in an eerie tone. Th, that's impossible. How did you beat the first trial so quickly? I'm familiar with this test. My past once plagued me, but I've long since accepted myself and my story. Your little tricks are nothing to me. I see. That makes sense. You're not like the others. I finally understand why Satella brought you here. She brought me here. Why? Allow me to tell you what Satella brought you here for. Naruto opened his eyes, regaining consciousness. He remembered through the haze of his mind that he entered to look for Emilia since the lights went off, then he found her and took the trial himself. It was nothing to him, really. He had already taken that test, so he also understood how it could be difficult to others. Right, I took the trial. He said. He smiled a little at being reminded of his friends, his family, even though it was just an illusion of his past. It was nice seeing them. Naruto, Emilia is over there. Kurama said, reminding him why he was here in the first place. The blonde shinobi nodded as he started to get up. He found Emilia collapsed in the back of the room. He to check on her and felt some relief until he noticed her expression. She was mumbling in her sleep with fear and a pained expression, her emotions were a mess. Her face is twisted in agony, and she was covered in sweat. Her arms and legs are rigid, perhaps to stop her from moving about in her distress. If Emilia's trial was the same as Naruto's, that means she must have had a dream about her past, but Emilia's past was plagued with suffering, especially the day Roswell found her. Naruto didn't know how much times passed since he fell asleep and when he asked the tailed beast. They didn't know either since they fell asleep to concentrate on protecting his mind of any harmful effects of the trial. But, looking outside to the moon, he guessed it had been about 30 minutes since. Emilia looked like she wanted to cry. The blonde could only look at her in concern, hoping that his thoughts alone could help her, but being unable to do anything since he thought that she was still in her trial. But then, Emilia's once rigid limbs began to flail uncontrollably, reaching for something, anything, in her desperation. Her expression got worse and she actually looked like she was suffering. Seeing that leaving her in that state was basically leaving her gets tortured, he embraced her and tried with all his might to interrupt the flow of magic in her mind, to stop the illusion from plaguing her mind any longer. Emilia. Hey, calm down. Emilia. He had to be careful since Emilia's mind had no chakra pathways, worst case scenario he could fry her mind and leave her brain dead, or he could release her and risk her going brain dead due to the increasing stress the trial was forcing on her. The choice was obvious, so with a concentrated burst of chakra Emilia went limp for a few seconds before she began breathing slowly, her heartbeat slowing down as well. It was after a few more minutes of deadly silence that Emilia finally began to stir in her sleep, slowly opening her eyes. Nah, Naruto. She said, sounding exhausted. Are you okay? Naruto asked as she nodded. Take it slow. Take a deep breath. Emilia was breathing as deep and as slow as possible, filling her lungs with precious air and helping her mind comprehend what was going on. He lifted her in a princess carry, not wanting Emilia to stay resting in a brick wall. The half-elf looked around only to find darkness, her mind still rebooting after her trial. In a dark place, alone with Naruto. Emilia said. Just calm down. He was rewarded with silence for a few minutes before Emilia began to shiver. I remember. I took the trial, and... She gasped as she suddenly hugged herself. No, that, I didn't, mean to. Emilia? Naruto said in concern. Her voice was shaky, and she couldn't make solid sentences. Her hold on herself tightened, and her teeth began to chatter as if cold, she shook her head, repeating the same sentence, it wasn't me. I didn't do it. Emilia covered her face with her hands and began to cry. Hearing her sobs filled with pure sorrow broke Naruto's heart. He decided to stop walking to the exit, figuring that Emilia wouldn't want the others to see her like this. He helped her get to her feet and just embraced her when she could stand in her shaky legs, connecting his chakra with her magic as best as he could to bring her as much comfort as possible. It's okay. You're okay. I'm with you. I'm here. You're not alone. He said, gently patting her back as she shook and cried. Her face was hidden in his chest, trying to stay as close to his warmth as possible, reminding herself that she wasn't alone. D.L. Leave me, Naruto. P. Please, don't. She called desperately. I'm not going anywhere. I'm here. She finally calmed down. Ram said to the worried Naruto. He sat on a chair right beside Emilia while she's sleeping on the bed, the poor girl not wanting to move from his side, he guessed that it had to do with his chakra invading her body and soothing her mind. Ram had no idea which events made Emilia like this, but guessed that it had to do with the lights going out suddenly. When both of them came out of the tomb, Naruto was leading a shivering Emilia who looked like she was trying to merge herself with his arm. She looked at Emilia's eyes, but when they locked their gazes it was as if she was looking through her, piercing her soul with lost eyes, it scared her. Naruto-kun, what did you say about the trial? Facing your past, was it? Rem asked since Naruto tried to explain to them what had happened but was more focused on reaching the hut they were staying in, as a result, he said a bunch of random things, at least to them they were. Correct. The first trial is about facing your past, your fear, your guilt, and things that make you unable to cope with your past. Naruto explained, now speaking in no hurry. There are three trials, but unfortunately, if two people enter the tomb together, it wouldn't let us do the second one. That means she'll have to try again. Rem said.
I'm surprised you passed the first though.
Louis said.
How did you do it?
Trust me, I've dealt with these things before. Naruto said before he heard Emilia moan. The silver-haired girl was now awake, but her mood was. It's hard to describe her mood, her facial expression seemed sad, guilty, and ashamed.
I am so sorry, for causing so many problems. Inside the tomb, and now.
She said.
It's alright, Emilia.
The blonde said as he used his hand to stroke hers gently.
How are you feeling?
Naruto-kun, I think it'll be better for us to leave you two alone. Rem said with a smile, knowing that Naruto would be able to comfort Emilia better if they were alone.
Rem left the room first.
Ram came second, dragging Garfield by his collar. Louis wanted to ask Naruto some things, but thought it better to leave them alone in the room, for now. All other people were gone now, leaving the two alone. Naruto looked at Emilia's face in concern. She seemed really exhausted and shook after she took the trial.
Emilia, are you okay?
I am okay.
I failed my trial, B, but it's okay.
Emilia said, her voice and her body shaking.
I'll do it again.
I am already, starting to know what happens in it, in the trial.
Alright. Her eyes shed tears, breaking Naruto's heart to see her like this.
Emilia, don't blame yourself.
It's okay.
Tomorrow, I'll take the trial for you.
He tried to calm her before she hurt herself in her sorrow, but that seemed to be the wrong thing to say.
And Naruto, you can't leave this to me.
What?
You saw me doing badly, so you're thinking you can't leave the trial to me, so, in my place.
No, I didn't say that dash.
No, I can tell what you're thinking, Naruto.
Why you were able to overcome it properly, but far from overcoming it,
I hadn't even resolved myself to face it, that past, with this trial.
Emilia shook her head, not listening to Naruto's words.
Her lips trembled slightly.
This wasn't good for her, she was torturing self, something he could not save her from, unless she wanted him to.
But if I don't face it, I won't overcome the trial.
Right, that's right.
If I don't overcome the trial, don't overcome the past.
I'll never be a ruler.
If I don't let the villagers, and people from sanctuary outside dash, whatever Emilia going to say was cut off by Naruto who pulled her into a hug.
Emilia, don't.
He muttered while patting his hand on her back.
You don't have to do this to yourself.
Please, relax and rest.
Everyone looked at me, because.
Mother and me.
No.
Th, that's not true.
The truth is different.
Back then,
You don't have to remember, Emilia.
Please, calm down.
Naruto tried to comfort her.
Why won't you be mad?
Why you saw how I failed, but you're still being kind to me.
Emilia said, her hold on him tightening.
Because I love you, Emilia.
I'm not mad at you for trying and failing, I'm sad that you're hurting yourself like this.
Naruto said.
I'm here for you.
If you ever need me, you can always count on me.
Remember that I'm your knight and most importantly, you're my girl.
I want the best for you.
Emilia widened her eyes, more tears flowing down, and she let out choked sobs before she buried herself in his chest. She let out a wail and cried out, never letting go of him until she ran out of tears.
Naruto could tell she had a horrible past and wouldn't stop blaming herself for it.
This situation was really beginning to creep him out and he was catching himself thinking silently about it more and more. Emilia was more or less his mirror image, an outcast of society that had no hand in her pain but was still going out of her way to try to not only change the minds of those that hated her but also lead them into a better future.
Even the very situation they were in mere moments ago was similar to one of his own journeys, she was trying to cope with her past and overcome her demons in order to be the best version of herself, just like he did once upon a time. The main difference was that she had some people in her life already while he had to start from nothing, and he was going to be damned if he abandoned her now. He understood that Emilia would trip and fall in her way to being the person she wanted to be, but she would have him to fall back on.
He was determined to help her reach her goal.
To see her bloom into a powerful mage that would be feared by her enemies and a wise king who would lead her people to greatness. They stayed together for several minutes, not speaking to each other, only seeking comfort and warmth from their embrace. Naruto's chakra and presence managed to calm her down, she was no longer shaking anymore.
Feel better now?
He asked, uncaring for his now stained shirt.
Yes. She muttered while snuggling in his chest.
That's good then. He noticed she didn't let go of him and that she had no intention of doing so anytime soon. They stayed together for another minute until Amelia reluctantly let go. When they were face to face, she couldn't help but notice his azure eyes and the care hid deep beneath them. This, in turn, made her realize that they were back to the position they were in when he woke up from meeting with Echidna, but this time she didn't back off. Her heart desired something at this moment, and Naruto was the only one who could give it to her, damn those books and their sweet words, so she just lunged for it. Who knew why she did what she did at that moment? Was it because she was tired? Because she was emotionally damaged? Or perhaps because she just wanted to? She certainly didn't understand what was going on. Not until her lips tasted another pear. She saw Naruto's eyes widen slightly before he relaxed and allowed her to do what she wanted to. The moment was magical to her, her stomach was filled with little butterflies, her lips felt as though in heaven, her mind shut down for a second before rebooting, and she felt lightheaded. It was nothing more than an innocent gesture of the love she felt for the man in front of, but for some reason, those seconds meant so much for her. When they finished, they only looked at each other's eyes, both with rosy cheeks. She changed her mind, her books could not describe the feeling she was experiencing at this moment. Amelia grasped his hand with hers, feeling a pit of dread forming when she thought of Naruto. She didn't care where, she just wanted to stay with him, be it in her world or in his, it mattered little. But for now, she was content with her life, who knew how the future was going to be, but she'd crossed that bridge when she was there. She felt his hand hold her cheek and clean the tears she didn't know she had shed. She grabbed his hand before it got away as she placed it on her cheek again to feel his warmth. Now you feel better? Naruto asked, looking at Amelia who nodded to him. That's good, I was already missing your smile. Amelia giggled softly and finally lied down on the bed, her mind shutting down without her wanting it to. Naruto, see, can you sleep with me tonight, I want to rest in your arms. The half-elf said with a blush on her cheeks, using every drop of energy to try and convince him. The blonde smiled softly before kissing her forehead, he took off the black sweater and his headband as he placed them on the drawer. He slipped into bed with Amelia, his arm encircling the half-elf. Amelia moved closer to him and hugged back, their foreheads touching, and staring into each other's eyes. Her head was now resting on his shoulder in a position only lovers would use, but neither cared enough to move away. They finally fell asleep with Amelia nuzzled into Naruto's chest. She enjoyed in Naruto's arms and felt so much safe with him. She wouldn't remember the next day, but that night she had the best dreams. Echidna sat on her chair in the grassland that was her dream, drinking tea with a smile on her face. Strange, why was she smiling? Normally she would have an uninterested scowl or an evil smile. She was thinking about her new acquaintance, Naruto. The young man certainly brought a smile to her face, he was at no point hateful toward her and didn't seem threatened at all. Naruto was a singular human, her favorite interaction with him was probably the whole, tea makes you small, thing. Echidna let a warm giggle, how entertaining those few seconds were, she was looking forward to his arrival. Too bad he's gone. He's a strange one. She said before her eyes turned serious. She felt familiar mana approaching her position. But perhaps that's just what I should expect, from someone you're entrusting your feelings toward. Only to him. Only to him. Only to him. Only to him. A soft but powerful voice repeated that sentence. Sealed up in your castle, and even with the occasional meeting, fears and winds are being made to forget. What a predicament, you can be so insistent. Not that I can comprehend it. She said, her voice now devoid of any emotion. Don't touch my beloved. Don't touch my beloved. Echidna's brows furrowed in displeasure to the figure in front of her. Before her eyes, the figure of a woman appeared. A silhouette clad in a pure black dress, with long, silver hair. An ominous, black shadow covered everything from her chest upwards, her face not visible. The Witch of Greed accepted the presence of this thing, which suddenly appeared after Naruto's departure as if it were natural. As if she knew it was going to happen. Call it a natural result. You get to stomp around recklessly through the heart of your dearly devoted. I tried not to touch any of your domains, but I suppose you too can't keep from the encroachments. She asked. Even a finger. Even a flap of skin. Even a nail's cuticle. Even a single hair. Even one bead of sweat. Even one drop of spit. Even one single word. Even one gasp of breath. Even one fragment of emotion, all of it.
belongs to me, is what you mean. My goodness, when I'm with you even I want to forfeit my name of greed. I can't conceive going so far for just one single person. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. And so, envy surely would not forgive greed for touching what was hers. The figure took a step forward. By that action alone, the whole grassland was swallowed by shadows. Echidna barely managed to avoid damage by jumping backward, but the shadow took the form of an arm as it perused her, aiming for her neck. She let a single sigh slip. Being erased here would make me leave behind more than a few regrets. You forced me to take a rather cowardly way out. Dash, right after Echidna ducks, the arm aiming for her was abruptly deflected by another very similar in nature. So incessant with the summonings, ha. Huh? Can't get any peaceful sleep, Hugh. A familiar voice said, it was Sekhmet. She flopped on the floor not wanting to stay on her feet. This didn't discourage the shadows that repeated their actions. But. Ha, huh, it's not good. The same happens as shadows fought an almost invisible battle. Half of the darkness subsided. The silhouette raised its head loosely, lifted its right arm, and pointed at Sekhmet. Commanded by the simple action, a huge swarm of arms sprung out of the shadow covering half the room. A black curtain of death was heading toward the lazy witch in the floor. Didn't just I tell you, it's not good, Hugh. The whirlpool of black shadow arms dissipated in an instant, and the after effect of it slams into the silhouette, shooting her toward a wall made by more shadows. Sekhmet hasn't moved at all during all of this and is still just sitting there with her knees in her hands. The silhouette's body started breaking down, still getting assaulted by Sekhmet's attack. With most of your powers sealed, ha. Huh? And while inside a castle made by that mean-spirited Echidna, Hugh. In a condition inferior to your true strength, you've no chance of beating me, Hugh. Sekhmet yawned. The attack stopped and the figure fell to its knees when a merciless blow from above crushed it. Doping to the floor after the merciless assault, Envy looked at Greed. Why interfere with me? Why interfere with me? Why interfere with me and him? Ha! Huh. Even answering would be a pain. Sekhmet said as she watched Envy's shadow being scattered into nothing. This is such a pain. How was that again? Oh! Who, what a drag.
If you like this content, don't forget to like and subscribe. See you later, bye bye.